Westland and Alliance Church this morning. It is our joy to welcome you here. Before we get started, a number of announcements. The first, if you are new or visiting with us this morning, we would love to know of your visit. We would love to know how we can pray for you. If you're thinking about getting connected in the church, we would love to know how we can get you plugged in. The easiest way we have to know these things about you is for you to scan that QR code and fill out the connection card. This is a great tool we have to know how to pray for you, how to get a hold of you, how to get you connected into different ministries in the church. If you're looking to volunteer, this is how you can sign up for that. So if you can scan that QR code and fill out the connection card, that would be a great help to us and would allow us to serve you well. That's announcement number one. Announcement number two, our biblical counseling ministry is making available some soul care resources for Christmas. So there's got some reduced prices, and limited quantities. Okay, so they're on sale, and there's not many of them. So if you would like some, get them quickly. Your orders are due by December the 15th, Wednesday, December 15th. Orders must be in, and we'll get them to you on time for Christmas. So there's some good resources there on things like anxiety and fear, dementia, or caring for aging families, depression, suicidal prevention, biblical soul care, chronic pain, different sort of things, different resources to help equip you to care well for yourself and those around you. So if you're interested in some of those, you can get a hold of Rick and get a flyer from him and look at some of what's available. So remember, those are reduced prices, limited quantity. Orders must be in by Wednesday, December 5th. Third, members meeting. We have a members meeting this evening here in the sanctuary. We're going to have three of these this year. Tonight is the first one. There'll be some singing, some worship, and then Pastor Jude is going to be teaching on church discipline. And now we're calling it a members meeting, but because this is our first one, tonight is open to everyone. So if you're here, you're an attender, you're not yet a member, you are more than welcome to come this evening to hear Pastor Jude teach on church discipline, on church membership, as we roll towards starting some more of these meetings on a regular basis here at the church. So tonight, 7 o'clock, here in the sanctuary, our members meeting that is open to all. Like I said, be some singing, some teaching. Pastor Jude is going to be teaching. Next announcement, we have our Christmas initiative. Every year we run different Christmas initiatives. This year we are continuing on in that tradition, partnering and supporting local community outreaches here in the area. There are a number of organizations that we are partnering with this Christmas, and we plan to support a number of them financially. But because of your existing faithfulness in giving to WLA Cares, we don't need any more financial gifts this season. So we're asking if you would donate physical gifts. That you can see on the way in that there's a spot there for you to drop stuff. We're looking for foodstuffs or different things for different organizations. So we're looking for clothing, boots, hygiene products, all this sort of stuff that we can be giving out to different organizations and to those in need. So you can start bringing those here to the church starting today throughout the week. You've seen already on your way in the foyer, there's a spot there to drop donations. So if you have stuff you would like to give, bring it, drop it, and we will get it to where it needs to go. Finally, we have some exciting announcements as well. We have some new babies in the church family. First, we are excited to announce the birth of Philo Kim Connors, born November 27th, 2021, 6 pounds, 8 ounces, born to Darren in Erie. So we got Philo Kim Connors. You're allowed to clap, guys. Babies are exciting. And Lucy Janine Jameson, born December 1st, 7 pounds, 9 ounces, born to Lucas and Mary. So we rejoice in God's good gift of children to his children, and we pray that the Lord would save these infants and raise them up to love and follow and serve him well. But this morning we are here, we're gathered together as a group of believers in this place to worship our good God. So as you're able, why don't you stand to hear God's word read, and then we will sing a couple songs together. Isaiah 53 says this, "Who has believed what he has heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him smitten, stricken by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Friends, as we gather this morning to begin our Christmas series, we're remembering the fact that Christ came, and Christ came with a purpose. He came with the purpose of redeeming for himself a people. So let's sing now as we think about the fact that our great Savior was born a man, and when he was born, there was much rejoicing. This morning we're going to teach you a new song. It's called Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery. It might not be new to all of you, but it's new for us as a congregation. The song is a wonderful call for us to think about who it is Jesus is and what it is Jesus has done. The first verse goes, it says, Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. He, the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. Let's sing this song together.
Come behold the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity, in our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, He the perfect Son of Man, in His living, in His suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. See the truth. Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when He comes.
Amen. You may be seated.
We are back to our catechism this week, continuing in our catechism to work through the Ten Commandments. And so this is another reminder to the kids and to the parents of kids that I've put out a challenge for them to memorize and recite the Ten Commandments on video and to send it into me, and I will reward them for doing so. I've talked to some kids who have assured me they are learning them, and we're going to say the cutoff is the end of the month. So kids, get working on that. And today's question 10 of our catechism, continues to teach us about the Ten Commandments. And here's what the question asks. What does God require in the fourth and fifth commandments? And here's the answer. Fourth, that on the Sabbath day we spend time in worship of God. Fifth, that we love and honor our father and mother. Kids, let me encourage you this Christmas season in particular. Could you focus on that fifth commandment to love and honor your father and your mother? That would be a great thing for you to do this Christmas season, is to show them respect and to love them and to make sure that they understand how much you appreciate them. Maybe that's something for you to try this Christmas season, kids. Congregation, let's pray for the children. Father God, we thank you again this week for the children of Westland Alliance Church. We thank you for each and every one of them, for the blessing they are to their family and the blessing they are to our church. Father God, ultimately we pray that you would save each one of them, that you would draw them to yourself, that you would open their eyes to your glory in the face of Jesus. We pray that you would also, Father God, use their teachers, their parents, to communicate to them the truth of God's word and help them to walk in that. Watch over them today. Bless them this coming week. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Our elder that will lead us in prayer this morning is Gerald Hayes, and so I'll invite him to the stage.
Let us pray together. Our Father, we acknowledge on this third Sunday of Advent that we are overwhelmed once again as we reflect on the incomparable riches of your grace demonstrated in the incarnation of your one and only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. He took on flesh, sharing in our humanity, so that through his death he could make atonement for our sins and reconcile us to yourself. We ascribe all glory to you, for you alone are worthy. Hallowed be your name. Forgive us, Father, for our selfishness, our pride, our lack of faith, and our failure to surrender fully to your will for our lives, thinking that we sometimes know better. So often we ask for your blessing in material things when we already have so much. We ask for your forgiveness, but fail to forgive those who trespass against us. Lord, cleanse us afresh today from all sin and unrighteousness. Purify our hearts and empower us by your Spirit to live for your eternal glory. Thank you for protecting us from the potentially serious effects of the virus, which has disrupted our regular lives so much in the last couple of years. We thank you also for taking Danny and Vera Karanji back to Serbia this week to continue their vital ministry. We thank you also for raising up two brothers in our Arabic ministry to share the load with Brother Rand. And we pray that you would strengthen and empower and guide them as they do so. Comfort those of us who are grieving the recent passing of a loved one. Grant healing and deliverance to those who are struggling with the effects of various illnesses such as asthma, chronic fatigue syndrome, loneliness, anxiety, substance abuse, Lyme disease, or even cancer. Some in our church family have just gone through surgery, and some are facing major surgery in the coming days. They need to experience the reality of your comfort and peace. Father, make your presence and sufficiency very real to each of these, your children, we pray. We remember also our missionaries of the week, Mike and Nikki Howell, as they serve you in Senegal, West Africa. Praise the Lord. We praise the Lord together for the good connections that you gave to Mike following that recent soccer tournament he organized. And we pray that you'd guide Mike and Nikki as they follow up those connections and seek to present Christ in all his fullness to them in this season. We also remember their health situation, and we pray that you'd restore them to full health after being knocked down by the flu bug recently. And now as Pastor Jude comes, we pray that you'd empower him as he brings your word to us this morning. Help us to see Jesus with clarity and conform us to the image of Christ as a result, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, this morning we take a break from our Hebrews sermon series, sort of. In fact, we're doing a three-week sermon series focused on Christmas. However, it comes out of Hebrews. So in one way, we're putting our Hebrews sermon series on pause, but in another way, we are just investigating it further. The title of this sermon series is Flesh and Blood. Flesh and Blood, which sounds a little bit macabre, I would guess, in regards to Christmas. And yet, I think you'll understand why we have entitled that in just a moment. My sermon this morning also maybe comes across as a little dark. The title is Born to Die. Born to Die. The passage in Hebrews, which will be the platform for this Christmas series, is one of the most prominent verses of Scripture that speaks of the incarnation. Now, the incarnation, for those of you who don't know, maybe you haven't heard that word before, is the theological term used to describe and explain the fact that Jesus became a man. God the Son added to his fully divine nature a fully human nature, which consists of a human mind, human emotions, a human will, human motivations, and a human body. In the incarnation, that word incarnation actually means enfleshment, the taking on of flesh. In the incarnation of Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, who was eternally and fully divine, became the God-man. It is truly the incarnation of Jesus that we celebrate at Christmas time. When Jesus Christ was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, the promises of God concerning a Redeemer became part of human history. And that is what we continue to celebrate to this day. So why don't you turn with me to Hebrews 2 in your Bible or on your device? And we will look at Hebrews 2, 14 and 15, the verses which will be the platform for this three-week series at Christmas time called Flesh and Blood. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14 and 15. I'm reading out of the English Standard Version. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. Let me read that again, and as I read it, keep in mind that our sermon series through Christmas will be three sermons, the first born to die, the second born to destroy, and the third born to deliver. Let's read those verses again. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. The purpose of the incarnation was salvation, a salvation through substitution in which Jesus, the God-man, would die for the sins of his people. Jesus became flesh and blood that he might die. We speak accurately when we say Jesus was born to die. Now, this morning, I want to use four words to lead us into an investigation into the incarnation as we navigate the aspect of the incarnation which causes us to say Jesus was born to die. Here's the four words: indestructible, indistinguishable, incomparable, and indicative. Let's start with indestructible. Jesus became a man in order to die a death that God, without a human nature and therefore indestructible, could not die. Jesus became a man so that he could die. Now, the first chapter of John's Gospel is one of the places in Scriptures where we can see clearly, I believe, that Jesus was divine. He was the divine Son of God. He was God himself. And we can also see that he became a man. If we start with the first three verses of chapter 1 of the Gospel of John, we read this: in the beginning was the Word. The Word is John's way of describing Jesus and attributing to Jesus certain things, where it'll suffice to start to simply understand that the Word refers to Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Jesus was divine. He is God. And then we read in verse 14 of John chapter 1 that Jesus, the Son of God, who was God himself, became a man. Here's verse 14. And the Word, Jesus, became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Now, there's not an explicit mention to the death of Christ, but we read this in verses 9 through 11. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. What you learn later in the Gospel of John is that not receiving of Jesus was also the killing of Jesus. Now, Jesus became a man in order to die because he would not have been able to die otherwise. Jesus, prior to his incarnation, could not die because he was God. And as God, he always existed and could not cease to exist in any understandable sense, certainly to us. Psalm chapter 90, verse 1 and 2 says, Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. That speaks to the fact that God is immortal. He has always existed from everlasting in that direction, and he will always exist from everlasting in the other direction. Further to that, we see in the book of Hebrews, which we will get to in a few months in chapter 7, that Jesus is described himself as indestructible. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 15 and 16. This becomes even more evident when another priest, that's Jesus, arises in the likeness of Melchizedek, who has become a priest not on the basis of a legal requirement concerning bodily descent, but by the power of an indestructible life. So the author of the letter to Hebrews talks about Jesus and says he has an indestructible life. Now, there is some arguments among the commentators about the indestructibleness of Jesus to his divine nature. Others saying, no, that's speaking to the resurrection. Well, I take the same position as John Owen on this. I mentioned to you John Owen has a magisterial commentary on Hebrews. And he says this about the indestructible life of Jesus. It is not absolutely the life of the human nature considered separately from his divine, but it was the life of the person of the Son of God, of Christ as God and man, in one person. The indestructibleness of Jesus speaks to the fact that he was resurrected, certainly, but it also speaks to the fact that he was God, and God cannot die. And so Jesus demonstrated himself to be indestructible, and certainly he did so in the resurrection, but he has been from eternity past indestructible because of his divine nature. Jesus was born to die speaks to, among other things, the necessity of Jesus becoming a human being because a fully divine being cannot die. God is indestructible. The incarnation was necessary for Jesus to die because it was only in his human nature that he could experience death. Jesus was born to die. The second word that helps us understand this phrase, Jesus was born to die, is the word indistinguishable. Jesus became a man because only a man could pay for the sins of men. Jesus was, in the sense of the essence of his humanity, indistinguishable from every other man or woman. He was truly a human being. And this was necessary, because nothing else except a man, a human being, could pay for the sins of humanity. We read again in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 4, It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. You see, the Israelites had a system, a religious system, whereby they sacrificed animals to deal with their sin. And yet the author of Hebrews makes it clear, the sacrifice of animals, the death of animals, the blood of animals, it is impossible for that to truly take away sins. The Heidelberg Catechism, one of the famous catechisms from Christianity's history, one that our New City Catechism is built off of, addresses the necessity of Jesus being a man and a man paying the price for our sin in question 16. The question in the Heidelberg Catechism goes like this: why must he, Jesus, be a true and righteous man? Why must he be a true man and why must he be a righteous man? Well, the answer to why he must be a true man is this: he must be a true man because the justice of God requires that the same human nature which has sinned should pay for sin. God has determined that to truly pay for sin, a man, a human, must pay for sin. Jesus was born to die because only a man, only a human, could pay for the sins of men. As the second person of the Trinity, before the incarnation, Jesus could not pay the penalty for humanity's sin. And so he had to become a man. And so we can say Jesus was born to die. The third word that helps us understand the phrase Jesus was born to die is incomparable. Jesus became a man that he might die a death that could actually atone for sin. Now, I have just said that only a human could pay the penalty for the sins of humanity. But this point of incomparable, focuses on the fact that it couldn't be just any man who could die for the forgiveness of sins. It had to be Jesus. Though in his essence, as a human, he was indistinguishable from humans, he was nevertheless incomparable to the rest of humanity in the living of his life. Again, John Owen notes, sin could not be taken away without a price, a ransom, a compensation, and satisfaction made unto justice for the injuries it received by sin. But there must be a proportion between the injury and the reparation of it. There must be a correspondence to the payment of sin and the severity and evil of sin. And there is only one human being who ever lived whose death would be proportional to the severe penalty that was required for the sins of the world. And that one human being was Jesus. Now, we have this sense of justice even in our legal world, in our legal system. We have the saying that if you commit the crime, you do the time. But there is a sense, even in our fallen world, that the time a criminal does must be proportional to the crime he has committed. We would understand the injustice of someone stealing a chocolate bar being put in jail for life. We would say that's not proportional. And unfortunately, this day, we maybe experience it the other way. We hear of heinous crimes and then hear of people doing time that seems disproportionately short in compared to the evil that they have done. We have this sense of proportionality of the payment of injustice. Jesus was the Son of God and God himself. And as God, Jesus was glorious with all the divine attributes of God. And as a man, Jesus' works in life were unmatched. His words were unparalleled. As the God-man, he was the Messiah, the Davidic king, who would become, as we heard this morning, the suffering servant, who alone could pay for our salvation. He is the only man who could die a death that would be proportional to the sins of the world. We read in Romans chapter 5, verse 18 through 21, "Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one of act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. For as by one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. Now the law came in to increase the trespass, but where sin increased, grace abounded all the more, so that as sin reigned in death, grace also might reign through righteousness, leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." In order for grace to reign, it had to be through righteousness. There is only one human being who can claim righteousness, and that's Jesus Christ. In that way, as a truly holy and righteous, obedient servant of God, Jesus was incomparable. There have been many martyrs over the history of the church, many godly saints who lived godly lives, who we could look to and rightly aspire to be like them because of their Christ-likeness. But not a single one of them in their death could be said to have died a death that was a proportional payment to the sins of the world. In fact, their death couldn't even pay for their own sins, let alone someone else's. There was only one death that could be a proportional payment for the severity of sin's evil. It could only be the death of a perfectly holy, entirely sinless human being. Jesus' death as God's Son, as God Himself, as the spotless Lamb of God, as the sinless human messianic King is a death in which the value and worth matches and in fact far exceeds all the sins of mankind. In that way, He is incomparable. There is none like Him. If Jesus was not our substitute and redeemer, the perfectly holy, perpetually obedient, undeniably righteous Jesus, if He was not our substitute, there would be no forgiveness for our sins. It could only be Jesus. In that way, we rightly say Jesus was born to die. The final word helping us understand this phrase, born to die, is indicative. Indicative. Jesus became a man that in His death He might indicate how glorious God is. Brothers and sisters, even though we are focusing on the birth of Jesus, let me suggest to you this morning that the glory of God shines forth most brightly in the death of Jesus. Our apprehension of God's glory cannot be realized apart from the death of Jesus. Jesus' aim on earth was to glorify God, and so we can say Jesus was born to die. Now, certainly there is glory in the incarnation of Jesus. There is much glory in the incarnation of Jesus, without question. We read in John 1:14, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen His glory." John says, the Son of God became a man. He took on flesh, and we have seen His glory. There is glory in His birth. But in the death of Jesus, we see a fullness of the glory of God that cannot be seen solely by looking at His birth and His life. It's interesting that we read in Hebrews 2:9, we see Him who was for a little while made lower than the angels. That's speaking about Jesus and His incarnation. We see Him, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death. The author of the letter to the Hebrews talks about His death as the crowning of glory. As the crowning of glory of Jesus. Listen to these words by famous preacher Charles H. Spurgeon. "What shall I say of His death? Oh, never did the love of God reveal itself so clearly as when He laid down His life for His sheep. Nor did the justice of God ever flame forth so conspicuously as when he would suffer in himself the curse for sin, rather than the sin should go unpunished. Every attribute of God was focused at the cross. And he that hath eyes to look through his tears and see the wounds of Jesus shall behold more of God there than a whole eternity of providence or an infinity of creation shall ever be able to reveal to him. Jesus was born to die that he might portray the glory of God to the universe in an infinitely dazzling display of which we will revel in for eternity. The incarnation of God the Son was necessary so that the indestructible God could die. The incarnation of God the Son was necessary so that a human being indistinguishable in his humanity from other humans could pay the penalty for humanity's sin. The incarnation of God the Son was necessary so that the incomparable God could provide a proportional payment for the heinous sins of the world. And the incarnation of God the Son was necessary so that the fullest sense of the glory of God could be indicated. Brothers and sisters, Jesus was born to die. Let me make three points of application in regards to that this morning. Brothers and sisters, let me exhort you and encourage you this morning in the same way that we have so many times already through the book of Hebrews. This Christmas season, let's continue to consider Jesus, to look to Jesus, and therein find the encouragement and the example to persevere. That's what the book of Hebrews was. The author addresses believers whose struggles were tempting them to turn away from God and turn to other things. We are living in similar times. We are living in similar times. Maybe more so than any times we've experienced in recent history. Certainly, believers have always been challenged and tempted to fall away. But I suggest to you that in this day, we may be feeling that pressure greater than many of us have ever experienced before. I'd suggest to you, just anecdotally, in the last 6 weeks of this pandemic, I have seen more evidence of people sincerely struggling than I have in a long time. I have heard from congregants, of people in our own congregation, wrestling with the temptation to turn from Jesus. Struggling with their faith, considering something else instead of the way of Jesus and the cross and the discipleship that he brings to us. And so my admonition to all of us this morning is let's consider Jesus, let's look to him, certainly to his birth at this Christmas time, but understanding that he was born to die and continually looking to the cross and the salvation that he worked. And if you're here this morning and you are a believer who is considering turning from God, from walking away from your faith, can I encourage you, stick with us. Stick with us a few weeks longer. Stick with us this December as we consider the birth of Jesus and what that speaks to. Stick with us into the new year as we continue to work our way through the book of Hebrews, which speaks exactly to the situation you find yourself in. Continue to cling to Jesus. Don't fall away. The first point of application is let's continue to consider Jesus. Here's my second. Trust in God. Trust in God's providential ordaining of our lives. Let's put our faith in his purposeful sovereign control over all our circumstances. Jesus was born to die. And I know we're all born to die, but I think we understand that he was born to die in a different sort of way. First of all, as God, death was foreign to him. It was foreign to him. There is a condescension in God becoming a being that can die that we can't fully comprehend. We also understand that his death entailed a suffering that none of us will ever experience in his payment for sin. And finally, his was a death that was undeserved. He did not deserve to die. And yet, he was born to die, and he knew he was born to die, and he entrusted himself to God. He entrusted himself to God's sovereign and providential ordaining of his life. Brothers and sisters, let us do the same, particularly in our difficulties, particularly in our trials, particularly in our suffering. Let's trust God, even as Jesus did. Finally, my third point of application this morning is to encourage all of us this Christmas season to let the wonder of the incarnation lead us to worship the incarnated one. Jesus is glorious because Jesus is God. But the glory of God shines most brightly in the gospel, which speaks of Jesus' birth and life and death and resurrection. Let us wonder this Christmas season. And that wonder can bloom into worship as we consider him who was born a man that he might die a Savior. And if you're here this morning and you're an unbeliever, let me encourage you. This is the point of Christmas. Our society, our culture will say there's a lot of other more important things about Christmas, but I assure you this morning there is nothing more important than this. To consider Jesus in his birth, a birth that led to his death, and that death which is the salvation of all those who will believe and put their faith and trust in Jesus. If we turn from our sins, and if we believe in Christ, which is to say, to believe in who he is and who he was and what he accomplished, and to trust that for our salvation, that is the point of Christmas, that our wonder at the incarnation will lead us to worship the incarnated one. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning. As we turn our eyes and our hearts and our minds in this Christmas season to the birth of Jesus Christ, I pray, Father God, that you would help us to look through the lens of his birth to his death. That we would understand he was born to die. Father God, and as we consider that he became a man because he couldn't die otherwise, that he became a man because it was required that a man pay the penalty for sin, as we considered that not any other man could have paid that penalty, but only the perfect and holy and obedient Jesus Christ. And as we consider that Jesus in his birth and life and death and resurrection especially shines forth your glory, I pray, Father God, that you by your Spirit would make this a particularly special Christmas season, a special Christmas season of considering Jesus, a special Christmas season of entrusting ourselves to your providential care, and a particularly special Christmas of worshiping the incarnated one, Jesus Christ. It's in his name I pray. Amen.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace, streams of mercy. to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace now, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope, no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace, so washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. Shame was a ransom faithfully. Darkness rejoiced, so heaven had lost.
But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Friends, as we go this morning, let's not forget the wonderful fact that we have a God who became man to live and die and ransom for himself a people. And that is what we are celebrating at Christmas. And that's what we celebrate and remember every day. The Lord be with you.